Yeah, a lot of these guys in Silicon Valley, like they're just basically rents, like they're just basically tech feudal lords. They all want to be tech feudal lords, right? They do as little as possible, but be one of the elites so they can have control of things and they can suck resources out of everyone else, right?
Hello, my friends. I'm Carl Zha, and you're watching the Silk and Steel podcast, where I focus everything on China, history, culture, and politics. 4 months ago, I had a conversation with AI expert TP Huang on the AI race between U.S. and China, in particularly regarding DeepSeek. This conversation was originally released as an audio podcast on Silk and Steel podcast for my Patreon subscriber. Now I'm making it available on YouTube. Take a look.
You see, when DeepSeek got released, people in Europe were excited. They were like, "Oh, if DeepSeek can do this, we can do this too, right?" You know, because all the DeepSeek research is out there. Like, you know, other countries in the world can do this too. Not everyone in the world needs to be beholden to the closed AI models in America. That's whose goal is just to control everyone, right? They think they're gonna control the entire world, and that they're like these tech feudal lords, and when they achieve AGI, that they're gonna wake up and the rest of us are just going to be controlled by them in our daily lives. We're like little zombies that don't matter at all.
Speaking of AGI, artificial general intelligence ideas, AI will be so good, you'll be on par with a human mind and even surpass that. The whole idea, of course, of a tech sanction against China is to slow down China's AI progress so United States can reach Skynet and Terminator drones first, and China will be screwed. But how close are we? I mean, the whole premises of the AI competition is that they think the AGI is just around the corner, and then US is gonna win big, right? It's gonna it'll be so much winning. But how close are we to AGI, in your opinion?
It's really hard to say, you know, like there's things out there that could look like AGI to the layman, right? But whether they can do this efficiently, whether they have the same human intuition, because of the chain of thought on the DeepSeek R1, it makes me think we're actually a lot closer to it, like maybe a year or two away. Like the way that they're
Wow.
progressing, that it feels like it's we're like a year or two away. But the problem with AGI was the Silicon Valley bros, they have this very optimistic view in, you know, the hopium, that's what we would call, right, with AGI, that they believe that once we get to AGI, the computers themselves will just keep improving. Like you don't need human data anymore because the computers will generate the data and then consume it again, and then generate even better data and then consume and get smarter, keep getting smarter this way, and then eventually they can solve every world problem, right? And I've asked people like, why do they think it's such a powerful thing? And the answer I get is, well, they just want to say, think about the possibility. The possibilities are endless. I'm like, that doesn't mean anything. Okay, what are you producing? So people say, well, that means if you have as many data centers as possible that can run these AGI models, then it's like you have a million PhDs out there just developing stuff. So you're not limited by, you know, number of human minds anymore. And that it's almost very, it's almost like a religion for these peoples. It's very hard to understand, because they think everything can be solved once you reach AGI in the world. And I don't know, maybe it's possible. It's a one hypothesis, but maybe that seems a very scary future if the computers control everything that we do, right? That is like a very dark future for humankind if a bunch of data centers tell us what to do on a daily basis. That's like a very Terminator type world, right? So I don't know why they want that kind of universe, but they believe that they're gonna control the AI. But if the AI is so smart, they're gonna control the humans. So I don't know why these people are so excited about like a world controlled by computers and AI.
Yeah, I think this kind of fascination is very Silicon Valley. You know, this kind of mentality has been around since like I think like at least 1970s, and yet somehow they are so conceited, these tech lords, so conceited, they think they will be able to control Skynet, right? They'll be able to tell Skynet what to do.
The entire thing is Skynet-ish. Like, everything is Skynet-ish. Like, everything.
Now that DeepSeek is out, and it's what potential impact do you see going forward in the immediate future?
Okay, so the most immediate thing we're seeing right now is two things. One, everyone's using it. So you got to get more users into it. More users, the more data they have, and the more Chinese society starts using it. And then we're seeing right now is every OEMs in China are integrating it to their apps. So Huawei, Honor, Vivo, Oppo, Meizu, Lenovo, all the automakers going to integrate it eventually too. Like we've seen Geely, Zeekr, Great Wall Motor, Dongfeng, and IM Motor, so I'm pretty sure BYD is going to integrate through there too, and the Huawei cars are probably going to integrate with that too, right? And NIO, XPeng, all these guys are looking into it right now. It's all a matter of like how quickly you can integrate DeepSeek, because everyone wants to get in piece of pie on this. So the Chinese AI models aren't like OpenAI are going to get spread to the rest of the world, because the global south are going to use their Vivo phones or Xiaomi phones or their Honor phones or their Huawei phones, and they're going to be able to experience AI through their Chinese devices. So that's like the first outcome of this. The second outcome is that the Chinese data centers are going to get a lot busier, I would think, because before this, China had the problem where they're building a lot of data centers everywhere in China, and they have a lot more compute than people think that they have. And I tell people that they're swimming AI chips because I think that's how many they have. And people just don't realize how much chips they have. But, you know, you can have all these data centers, but if there is no usage for them, they're kind of just getting wasted, right? So the second thing is, as people start using them more and more around the world, whether it's through their phones, through their TV, or through their cars, or through their, you know, the web browsers, right? They are going to use it a lot. So this is actually a great time for China to build more data centers. And the one advantage that China has over the Western or over America is it's very good at building stuff and building it cheaply. It's very good at building a lot of like renewable energy in Western part of the country that are really cheap, very abundant, and it has a full domestic supply chain from this. Like recently, they just got into server DDR5 chip memory chips. So China is going to have like a full domestic supply chain for this. So the cost of building data centers and supplying the power is going to be so much lower in China than in America. So this is like a real competitive advantage. So one, you get more people to use it. And two, you build up the data centers that are actually going to get used because the inference cost is so much lower. And the third thing is, you're going to be using Chinese chips to do inference instead of Nvidia. You can still use Nvidia to do the training and stuff, but you can use Huawei chips to do inference. So all the compute out there, all the projection models out there that relied on people to use Nvidia chips to do all this computation, it's not needed. You know, you can make special inference chips in China that are better, much better cost to performance ratio, first of all. And even for general purpose AI chips like the Ascend Huawei chips, right? It can still reach like maybe 60 to 70% of the NVIDIA chips inference performance at a much lower cost. So you can just get better performance outright. You don't have to use NVIDIA. So long term, this entire theory about how greater usage in AI means more money for NVIDIA might not be the case, because if Chinese models get used a lot more and they use Chinese chips, then there just aren't going to be as much demand for Nvidia chips. So I think that's those are the two main things to watch out for, like whose country, which country's chips they're actually using, and how rest of the world uses AI. Because if you have a model where the rest of the world is using Chinese AI infrastructure instead of the American ones, these artificially high valuation for American tech company goes away, right? And a lot of the American growth in the past couple of years is just due to their stock market. It's like people, there's no fundamentals there. It's just basically stock market goes up, people see that they have more wealth, and then they can spend that capital gain on consumer goods, right? Whereas China has had like a couple of years where the capital gains are down because of the housing prices. But if you have the stock market going up because you see the tech companies are entirely undervalued in China. And recently we had a very high upward swing on the tech company valuation, purely due to DeepSeek, actually. A lot of it is due to DeepSeek and people being optimistic that China's gonna capture more of this AI pie. Then you can see a lot of capital gain driven consumer spending in China. So it's great for the economy.
Yeah, I mean, speaking about Chinese chips, how good is the Huawei Ascend chip compared to Nvidia H100? Is there still a gap that needs to be closed?
So that depends on whether you talk about training or inference, right? So training is when you're actually building the models. Inference is actually when you're using the models. So the gap is a lot less for the inference part of it. And a lot of people have thrown out the number that Ascend 910C is getting about 60% of H100's performance. And part of that is just because a lot of the libraries out there are optimized around the entire CUDA NVIDIA architecture. So there's going to be a lot of work required for Huawei and companies like DeepSeek to help integrate very low level code to optimize inference around Ascend chips for inference, right? I think training is a little further away, so they still need to do a little more work on that, but right now I would say they have enough NVIDIA chips in China to do the training. And so I think there's still like a gap between Ascend chips and NVIDIA chips when it comes to training, but inference, it's a completely different story. And that's where vast majority of demand is going to be, because if you can train your models on less resource like DeepSeek was able to do, and then run most of your models on Ascend, then you're fine. Like there's no issues here.
Yeah, so basically it sounds like there's really no computational bottleneck right now in China for Chinese AI development. And you point out something that China has abundant energy and it has a huge network of infrastructure to they have the power generation capacity to support more data centers. One of the doubt I have about this 500 billion Stargate plan of OpenAI and build massive data center in US, where are they going to get the power from? US power generation has been flat for the last 20 years. They're not building any more new power plants on a big scale the way that China has done. And I just find out, for example, why one of the US attempt to ban Chinese to slow down Chinese progress, for example, in renewable energy, is to ban imports of polysilicon, because they claim that the Chinese polysilicon is manufactured in Xinjiang, so they must be using slave Uyghur labor, so therefore you can't buy it. And it turns out a lot of polysilicon in China was produced in Xinjiang precisely because China is building a lot of solar and wind power in Xinjiang. China is basically covering desert with solar panels at this point. And all those extra power that's bringing online made the energy cheap, and making polysilicon is an energy intensive process, require electricity. So this is why a lot of the Chinese polysilicon makers, they chose to base their manufacturing operation in Xinjiang to access those cheap energy. And of course, US find that as a bogus reason trying to limit the import of solar panels from China because of that.
Hello, my friends. I'm Carl Zha, and you're watching Silk and Steel Podcast. Leave your comments below on what you think about this content and what would you like to see more on my channel. Thank you for watching. Bye-bye.